The Lord, come on, y'all with us here today. Thank you for joining us Wednesday night connect. We're waiting for people to log on and join us here. Amen. Come on, how many are blessed today? Amen. Praise the Lord. As more people log on here, y'all with us? You look pretty tonight, man.
Thank you.
I said, maybe you didn't hear me. I said, you look pretty tonight, honey.
Thank you, honey. You look handsome. Buy a new shirt?
No, I dug this out of my... The larger sizes of my closet. Praise the Lord. Come on. After we get out of there, listen. I got some exciting news for you tonight. Gyms open on May 18th. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm excited. Get back in that gym. Praise the Lord. I'm glad some of you are joining us here tonight. Continue to log on. We know a bunch of things are going on and more stuff is opening up. But right there, this is one of my favorite songs. Fred Hammond. Listen to this. Come on. I'm blessed. Love it, love it. Hope you guys are blessed. I know you are. Declare you're blessed in the name of Jesus. Amen. So we're excited to be joining y'all here tonight from our home again. We don't know how much longer this is going to go on, but tentatively, I think we're looking at probably around the first Sunday in June is what we're hoping to be able to get back into church and
Have full service.
And we want to be wise. We want to be as wise as we can as we go in there. But we want to be able to do it. Oh, I forgot to share this on our own page. But let me do that. But we want to be wise and definitely do it the wisest way we can. And so, but we're excited. We thank all you guys. I don't know about you, but I'm excited to get back to church, babe. You excited?
We are. So it'll be more than likely we're going to wait probably just another week or so to just see how things are going. But more than likely it's going to be Family Sunday in June. So the first Sunday of June is when we tentatively are going to be all together. So
yeah.
But once we know for sure... as you may know, the state of Texas has put out three phases as to when they want to fully open up the whole state. And phase two begins May 18th.
May 18th.
So we're going to see how things are going. So, I mean, things are opening up. The hair salons and barbershops, nail salons are going to be opening up this Friday. So little by little, our economy is going to be opening up again. The curve of all the sicknesses has gone down. Amen. So we're anticipating to have our services open again.
Amen. You know, one of the things, can you share this on our page? I'm trying to. I don't know how to do it. But anyway, one of the things that we're excited about, that we're praising God for, I don't know if everybody knows, but in the city of Houston, they actually started a medical tents, I believe at the NRG. And Sister Ashley Sandra Hita was involved with the Harris County. She now works for Harris County medical team that is overseeing the COVID patients. But anyway, she was part of that team that opened up tent hospital temporary. But thank God, I know a lot of people have their own opinion about it, but they're shutting it down. They never actually had to use it. Now, some people will be like, well, that's a waste of money. I think I'm looking at it on the other perspective where, you know, thank God that Houston didn't get as bad as New York and we didn't have to utilize that. You know, Houston was ready. It was in place. But I'm thanking God that we didn't get that out of control, that we didn't have to use that tent city. I mean, I could imagine all the people would have affected. But praise the Lord. We're still declaring and know good things are happening on God is still moving. Amen. Mm-hmm. So how many are blessed? Are you blessed? Come on. I want to see your comments. We're trying to do two things at once here. We want
to
see your comments.
On this page right here to look at the comments.
Okay. I got you. There we go. Amen. Brother Mondo, we see you. Brother Mondo Rivera. all the way from the valley. Karina, hi, Karina. We can't wait to get together. Amen. Lisa, I'm blessed. Yes, girl. Yes, you are. Amen. Joe, I love that song too, man. Sister Jesse, good to see you. All of you guys, I'm glad that you are logging on. Jessica, Marjorie. Listen, God is doing some phenomenal things. And so let me say this, that during this time, one of the things we got to be careful with is right now, and I kind of sense it, you know, I sense, you know, we're getting, we're in this spot here where we start to get comfortable. We start to even get used to the way things are going. I just want to encourage you not to become complacent. I know we're staying at home, we're not going to church, and we're not doing something. Don't get complacent. You know, I'm excited to get back to the house of God, but there is a, there can be a danger of becoming complacent where we are. So I want to encourage you, not just complacent physically as far as getting to church or not, but complacent as far as spiritually. Be careful not to become complacent. Man, stay engaged with God. Seek the Lord. Right? Don't replace your time with God with entertainment and stuff that, that feels like it's so easy to start watching Netflix shows and that just consumes you and start to, for me, it's been working around the house and getting things done. And so it can easily, you can easily become complacent with just being at home and filling those times with other things and neglecting your time with God. Mm-hmm. Don't neglect your spiritual side. It's and I know it's sometimes for some people it's hard to stay motivated during a time like this because you're in charge of your own motivation. You know, it's kind of like working out. You know, you're in charge of you. Nobody's going to tell you get to the gym. Nobody's going to tell you, hey, don't eat that. Nobody's going to tell you do this. Right now, we're in that position. You're in that position. We're all in that position spiritually. You are in charge of your own spiritual motivation and spiritual disciplines. And so I want to encourage you to do not become complacent at this time. Motivate yourself. Find a way to seek God. Find time with God. Open your word, not just the Bible. Look, there's great preachers on YouTube. You know, I know you think I'm the greatest out there, but you know, there's some other ones out there that do a good job too. Listen. Get out there, listen to the word, grab a good Christian book, read it. Take this time to fill yourself, not just with entertainment, other but with spiritual disciplines. So I encourage you, prayer and all that. Amen. Amen. And so do we have any other announcements? This Sunday is Mother's Day. Yes. Amen. To all of our moms, happy Mother's Day. And so we're, you know, it's hard not to be in church during Mother's Day. We're so used to being in church on Mother's Day. But I want to encourage you, we're going to have a good time this Sunday. Again, we're going to be on Facebook. Our services are going to be streamed. Facebook and YouTube. But we're going to, it is Mother's Day. So I encourage you, I'm sure you're going to probably, if you can, spend time with your mom. And we're going to have a great service this Sunday as well. Mm-hmm. Amen. And so tonight we have a special word. We have a special speaker. The First Lady herself is going to be sharing tonight. I'm just going to be the co-pilot. I'm just going to co-pilot with her tonight. I'm going to be commenting with you guys and talking on Facebook Live. So if you're there, do me a favor. Why don't you like and share this live post right now? Like and share it, comment, give me your prayer request, whatever prayer request you have, put it on here. We want to definitely be praying for you. We're going to pray at the end of the message, we're going to sit here and get into God's word. Amen. You ready to pray?
I am ready to pray.
Praise the Lord. We got a few people on, and I want to thank you so much for joining us. Come on, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity of being here. We thank you for allowing us to come on live one more time on Facebook, God, and be able to minister to people and share with people and fellowship with people. I thank you, God, because you're moving in the middle of all this. And I thank you that you allow us the technology to do this. I thank you that your spirit's here. I know there are so many people that are just blessed. God is just doing some great things. You're doing great things. Lord, and I honor you for that. I pray that you continue to move and restore and heal. And Father, that we will not grow complacent where we are, but that we will push ourselves and motivate ourselves to get closer to you. We honor you. We glorify you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And amen. Praise the Lord. Well, babe.
All right. Well, tonight I wanted to just speak to you guys and trust me, it's not, it's, it's not easy speaking to a camera of an audience of one. But we know that during this time, God has called us to still preach the gospel. God has called us to Amen. Still be the church. God has called us to still remain steadfast in Him. And so tonight I wanted to talk about maintaining your condition. What is the condition right now of your heart? What is the condition right now of your spiritual life? And so I want to open up with Psalms 25. If you have your Bible app there, you can, or if you have your Bible, because you're probably watching on your phone, I'm going to start reading in Psalms 25 and verse 1. It says, "In you, Lord my God, I put my trust. I trust in you. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one who hopes in you will ever be put to shame, but shame will come on those who are treacherous without cause. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you, my God, are my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long. Now remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old." Now jump to verse 12. "Who then are those who fear the Lord? He will instruct them in the ways they should choose. They will spend their days in prosperity, and their descendants will inherit the land. The Lord confides in those who fear him. He makes his covenant known to them. My eyes are ever on the Lord, for only he will release my feet from the snare. Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. Relieve the troubles of my heart and free me from my anguish. Look on my affliction and my distress and take away all my sins. See how numerous are my enemies and how fiercely they hate me. Guard my life and rescue me. Do not let me be put to shame, for I take refuge in you. May integrity and uprightness protect me, because my hope, Lord, is in you."
Amen.
Amen. Now, as I was reading this, the word uprightness, that's what caught my attention. The last verse that I just read in verse 21. Uprightness, sometimes I don't hear that word a lot, but that word uprightness, it kind of sounds like you'd be saying righteousness, but the word uprightness means to adhere to something that's righteous. It means to be honest or just. Basically, an upright person, a good person. But the verse says, "May integrity and uprightness protect me, because my hope, Lord, is in you." So this means to us as believers, this translates to us that we can go to God with our hope, but we have to take something with us. We can go to God trusting in him and hoping, but here in the scripture, it's saying, "Because my hope is in you, may integrity and uprightness protect me." So that means that when we're going to God, we're also submitting our petition to him. We're taking to him what our heart desires, but we're also submitting to him our integrity and our righteousness. Now, if you think about it, when I read that scripture, I thought about it. I'm like, huh, you know, anyone can go to God. Anyone can pray to God. Anyone can submit their petition to God. But how much more do you think God will listen to those that uphold integrity and righteousness? How much more do you think God may answer their petition? And so our God-given petition is righteousness. Basically, this is what we ought to be living. This is what we should be desiring to be doing, is living righteousness. Now, we know that the Bible says that even our righteousness is as dirty rags, but we should be striving to, even in every area of our life, submit it to God and make every area of our life righteous.
You know, I think one of the misconceptions is when we hear that word righteousness, we automatically think of perfection. We think, okay, everybody, I can't be righteous. You know, I'm not perfect. And we think that righteousness equates to perfection. But righteousness doesn't mean perfection. Mm-hmm. And I love this definition. I've been given this definition for years, and I don't even know where I got it from. But I heard somebody say it, and I read it somewhere, and it said, to be righteous means to be in right standing with God.
Yeah.
So to be in righteousness means that you're in right standing with God. Doesn't mean you're perfect. Well, how can you be in right standing with God if you're and be in sin? Because the Bible says love covers a multitude of sin. The Bible says that Jesus died for our sin. The Bible says that God's grace is sufficient. And so we can have sin. We can have struggles in our life. We can have battles in our life. And we can still be in a right standing position. Because, you know, I talked about David on Sunday. And David is one of my favorite people in the Old Testament. And the Bible says that King David was a man after God's own heart. And the reason he was after God's own heart was two reasons. Number one, he was a worshiper. Mm-hmm. God loves worship. And number two, he was quick to repent. He didn't hold on to his sins. He quickly repented and got right with God. And so that's what it means to be righteous.
Yeah.
And so when you talk about our God-given position is righteousness, that means the position God wants us in, mm-hmm, is to be in right standing with him. Yeah. To commune with him, to pray to him, to seek him, to go after him, to call him your father, and to serve him. And so when we talk about our God-given position is righteousness, it doesn't mean perfection. It means to be in right standing with God. Now, you can be far from perfect and be in right standing with God. Why? Because what's our position in Christ, our position in God is our position in Christ. Mm-hmm. And our position in Christ was created by what Christ did on the cross for us, mm-hmm, when he died for our sins. So the simple fact that he died for our sins, it purifies us. The Bible says his blood makes us white as snow. He takes our sins and throws them to the deepest part of the ocean. And so when we are in right, we're living in a righteous position, we're just living right where Jesus left us.
Yeah.
We're living under the blessing of the cross and the forgiveness of Christ. I'm sorry, babe. I forgot you were supposed to be teaching today.
That's all right. I'm like, here's my notes.
Come on.
So
we can do this.
Our God-given position, as he was saying, is righteousness. It's what we strive to do.
Amen.
But when we've done enough striving, when we've done enough trying to live right and be in right standing with God, what eventually comes out is holiness. Holiness in our lives. Holiness where your eyes are open to every area of your life, and you're like, is this thing that I'm doing, is it holy unto God? Is this area of my life submitting to God? Is it holy unto God? So that is basically like a something that is produced from living righteous. This is the benefit that we have, that when we're striving to live righteous, that holiness is produced, and in essence it's a closeness to God. It's us knowing what his heart is and how he desires. Amen. Even more of our life to look like and reflect like. It's interesting, like you just mentioned David, the writer of Psalms. You can, if you look at the book of Psalms and you see all of the different chapters, you can see where David is writing the Psalms, and he's, you know, he has his ups and downs. You see him talking about he goes from the valley up to the mountaintop, and then he's down to the valley again, and he's back at the mountaintop. And so you see he's up one moment and he's down the next, and he prays for God to forgive his enemies in one verse. And then he prays in another verse that God is going to destroy them.
On Sunday, he said, cut their head off and let me watch it.
So we see even David, the psalmist David, had his ups and downs. Even the psalmist David, you know, and the Bible describes him a man after God's own heart, a man that would submit himself unto God and try to hear the voice of God as much as he can. And God was pleased with him. Even him had his ups and downs. And so you can see the humanistic part of yes. him, yes. of the writer, when he's writing the Book of Psalms. It's like, I mean, I don't want to say like a bipolar person, but he has his ups and downs. But I think a lot of us can relate to that. He struggles sometimes to trust in God. But the one thing that we see when he's writing is the constant expectation of what God is going to do. His faith in God doesn't falter. Now, does he fully believe sometimes? Maybe he has doubt, but he knows that God is going to pull him through. He knows that God is going to be there. He knows that God is going to rescue him. He knows that God is going to be there to his left and his right. He knows that whatever the enemy tries to throw at him, God is going to protect him. So as similarly, many times our experiences in our life don't line up with our expectations. And, you know, just how he, maybe David was let down because he didn't, what he was believing for, he didn't fully get to receive. He didn't fully get to see. Sometimes we see that in our own life where, you know, sometimes our expectations are let down because God doesn't answer them whenever we want to. Mm. And so in essence, we can relate to David. You know, we're, you know, sometimes we're full of faith. Sometimes, you know, we're on a high and we're on the top of the mountain and we're praying to God and we're seeking him. And then the next day, like, boom, something hits us. Boom, a thought comes into our mind. Boom, somebody attacks us, you know, and it could be a family member. It could be a friend. It could be a coworker or man, like, boom, and here in this, you know, in this pandemic, you lose your job or your spouse loses their job or someone you know gets sick and you get hit left and right. But God wants our position to be Amen. Maintained in him.
You know, when you're talking about that, I immediately thought of Romans chapter 7, one of my favorite scriptures. Romans chapter 7, verse 14, it says, "We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And I do what I do not want to do. I agree with the law that it is good as it is. I no longer am myself who do it, but it is a sin that is living in me. Mm-hmm. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, but that is in my sinful nature. For I desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out." You know, Paul struggled with that same thing in Romans chapter 7, that he says, "Man, I want to do good. I don't want to sin. I don't want to do this." Come on, a lot of people know what I'm talking about. You know, you have that besetting sin, that thing you keep going back to that you really don't want to do. It's a battle. It's a fight to stay in righteousness, to stay in right standing with God. But you have this struggle, this thing in your life. You know, for everybody's different. You know, we all sin differently. We all sin, but we all may sin differently. Some sin in your mind, some sin in your flesh, some sin out loud, some sin in front of everybody, some sin in the closet and hidden where nobody else sees it. But Paul in Romans chapter 7 gets to this place where he says, "Man, I'm trying to live righteous. I'm trying to stay in the right place with God, but I got this thing that I keep doing that I don't want to do." And so we have to, you know, we're talking about maintaining our condition. We've got to understand that, man, a lot of this thing comes down to the grace of God in our life.
Yeah.
It comes down to God's mercy and God's grace in our life. There's not one person, I'm telling you, whoever looking at me right now, let me tell you something. There's not one person right now that is perfect, that is without sin. There's not one person that's never messed up. There's not one person that's never done anything wrong. And it's funny how we sit there and we judge each other and we look at each other and we cast stones to each other when we really need to stop and realize that the Bible says there's not one righteous, not even one, mm-hmm. not even one. And so when we're maintaining, in order to maintain where we are with God, we really got to lean a lot on the grace.
Yeah. And doing that, you know, sometimes the devil is going to use our faith and our grace to backfire against us, because the what he would want to do is to cause confusion in our mind. and make you believe that your faith isn't working.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I thought you believed in God. I thought that God was going to do this. And you're having faith and you're believing in God. How come it hasn't happened for you? How come you haven't gotten that healing? How come you haven't gotten that promotion? How come you haven't gotten that, you know, whatever it is that you're believing for? Mm-hmm. And the enemy will try to clog up your mind and fill up your mind with doubt and try to fill up your mind with things that are opposite of what God is trying to strengthen in your life. And what he does is when he causes doubt to come in, when you allow him to cause doubt in your life, you're basically allowing him to impose his will on you.
Yeah.
Because his will is to kill, steal, and destroy you. And he's not going to start it sometimes with your flesh. He's going to start it in your mind. Mm. He's going to start it when you're asleep, when you're alone, when you're mad, when you're upset, and cause you to think, well, they don't really care about you. Well, God doesn't really, you know, God loves them more, so he's going to bless them. He's not going to bless you. Or God's going to do this for them, but he's not going to do it for you. And one of the things that we need to be careful sometimes is man, even in our social media, because people are always going to put the best of what's going on in their life.
Yeah.
People are always going to put, oh, you know, living my best life, or, you know, God did this. But what they're not going to tell you are their struggles that they have. The struggles in their bedroom, the struggles with their children, their struggles with their spouse, their struggles, you know, when they're by themselves, crying themselves to sleep. No one's going to share their struggles with you. So we have to be careful when we're, even in this time, because we're on our phone so much, or even, you know, watching TV or on our computer, we see the life that everyone else is living, and then we compare it to ourselves. So we have to be careful that to not let what other people's life, it hinder what's going on in our life.
You know, it's funny, because what people give you on Facebook and Instagram, that's the highlight of their life. That's just a little glimpse of the highlight. They don't give you the messy stuff, you know what I mean? They don't give you the ugly parts. We give you the highlights, you know, what looks good. I mean, come on, you know, before we got up on Facebook Live today, you know, my wife didn't have all her makeup done and her hair done, and I wasn't sitting here and, you know, and had my hat on. No, we looked a little rough. But you clean up and then you get on Facebook Live and you look pretty and say hello, praise the Lord, everybody. But 5 minutes before we got on, we could have been fighting. You know, we could have been screaming at each other. But that's just the reality. Now, we weren't, but that's the reality. People like to put their best out there. And so we got to be careful, be careful not to judge people by what they put out there. Not to judge yourself. I'm sorry, to measure yourself. Don't measure yourself by what somebody else puts out there. Because anybody can do that. Praise the Lord.
And one of the things that becomes difficult when you're trying to maintain your condition and trying to maintain, you know, your faith in God is, you know, you're trying to do good. You're trying to pray. You're trying to... One of the difficult things that can come and happen is that you're trying to maintain your faith. You're trying to maintain, you know, okay, well, I'm going to watch church every Wednesday, every Sunday. I'm going to be faithful in this area. And then God doesn't meet your expectations. Mm. That can be a dangerous part in our Christian walk. That could be a dangerous part in our faith, is when we're doing so much and we're expecting God to do this.
Never preach.
And yes, and I know sometimes we say come with expectancy in our heart that we know that God is going to do it, but we also know that that's why Jesus says, not your will be done, not my will be done, but your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So sometimes I'm jumping ahead of myself because I have something else that I'm going to share, that sometimes we're believing so much of what we want, but we have to really try to come to the understanding, like, is this what God wants in my life?
Yeah, that, you know, that'll preach right there. The frustration of unmet expectations.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, I'm going to write that now. I got to preach that.
Maintaining our condition in him no matter what happens.
Yeah.
No matter if our expectations are met or not, no matter if our prayer is answered or not, no matter what happens in our life, We have to maintain our focus on Him, maintain our condition in Him, maintain our faith in Him. Because when you realize that, sometimes when you're focused so much on, you know, on Him and pleasing God, then sometimes the thought comes, am I doing enough? Am I doing enough to mm-hmm. please God? Am I doing enough in my faith? You know, maybe if I had a faith of as a small as the size of a mustard seed, maybe God would do this. And sometimes we feel inadequate in what we're doing unto God. And I think that's a human. That's a human part of us. I think that's all of us. Can we do more? Probably yes. Probably there's probably some area in our life that we can surrender more to God. There's probably a lot of areas in our life that we can surrender more to God.
Oh, yeah.
But maintaining our faith, maintaining our condition, you know, because sometimes when you're not doing enough, then you struggle with what God is doing. And faith is made strong in your work. So whatever it is that you're doing, whatever it is that you're giving unto God, whatever it is that you're submitting unto Him, stay strong in that.
You know, I think one of the mistakes that people make is when they're struggling with their relationship with God, or you're struggling in your life, the first thing people do is when people are very involved in church or serving, your tendency is to back away. It's to let me just back away. I'm not doing it. Let me back away. But I mean, I've been doing this thing for a long time. And I'm going to tell you, I've been pastoring all these years. I've been in ministry all these years. And I never had the luxury of being able to back away. I had to struggle. I had to go through my battles. And I had to still get up every Sunday, still get up every Wednesday, still get up and preach the word, still go, you know, in some of my worst moments. But here's what I found out. And see, the perception is this. People think you got to be perfect and you got to be in, everything has to be going great for you to get up and preach God's word. But can I tell you, in some of the worst moments and spiritual struggles in my life, it was when I pushed through and I got up and I did what God called me to do, yeah. Despite I was struggling. It's the fact that when I got up and took my position in God, that's what strengthened me to climb out of the difficulty I was in. That's what it was, the work of God that strengthened me. So sometimes the answer isn't backing away. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the answer is pushing forward. Sometimes the answer is pushing forward in order to draw closer. Why? Because that gift of God, you got to understand, you have a gift in you. You have a calling in you. You have a God desire in you. And you are your best when you're doing what God's called you to do. Even though when your condition is at its worst, you're still at your best when you step into the gift that God's put in you. When you step and activate that gift and that thing's coming out of you, it pushes your condition. It strengthens your condition. There's a thing in working out called condition training. Mm-hmm. They train your condition. That's what your gift does. When you do what God's called you to do, because you're talking about that, you don't make the mistake of backing away. Make an effort to move closer. Mm-hmm. That's what, and this is the type of season we're in, right? We got to move closer to God. We got to move closer in our spiritual response. We got to get back to what God is calling us to do. Soon as this church opens, you've got to run back and do what God's called you to do. Why? Because that's what's going to strengthen you and make your life stronger, make your family stronger, and attract the blessings of God in your life. I've seen it for too many years. I know God is true to that.
And when you're serving God, when you're praying to God, you'll notice the difference, because many times, many people, their prayers are egocentric and they don't realize it. They don't realize that their prayers most of the time in the beginning, when they're not knowledgeable of, or they don't have their Christian walk very strong, their prayers are, what can you give me, God? How can you bless me? Or how can you fix this issue in my life? God, I need you to do this, and this. And we come to God with so many things that God's like, okay, what else? And we come to God with all of these things, all of these petitions, all of these things. But when you're spending more time with God, when you are submitting yourself more to God, your prayer then changes. Your prayer, your prayer style shifts from being egocentric, from what can I get out of this, to being ultra altruistic, meaning what can I do for you, God? How can I please you? What can I do to further your kingdom, God? What can I do to further my walk in you? What can I do to further my faith in you, God? So your prayer shifts when you become closer to God. Your petition style shifts. It's not so much like, okay, like this is what I wanted in my life, but not my will. Your will be done. And many times as Christians, we do that. It's almost like we vomit to God. God, I want all of this. But God's like, but you haven't asked me what I would want of you. And that comes with maturity. That comes with, you know, knowing Christ and walking with him and hearing the voice of God and spending time in him and not losing your faith. That comes with maturity. So my question to you tonight is, are you praying, or are you just working or trying to look busy? What does your prayer life look like right now? Are you maintaining your condition, or are you getting weaker, or are you getting stronger?
Amen. You know, there's a scripture that says, and I think it's Mark 11 thing. It says, therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you receive it, and it will be yours. Yeah. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it. Now, that scripture is tough on a lot of people, because we prayed prayers before and God didn't answer. But you got to understand, when you were talking about how we pray and we're egocentric, but then our prayers is all about us. The closer you get to God, you know, Jesus said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. You got to understand, the closer you get to God, the closer you get him, what happens, if we don't even know it, the things that you used to desire, you don't desire anymore. Now you begin to desire what God desires. So that's why God says, pray, and God will give you the desires of your heart. God begins to give you the desires of your heart when your heart becomes like his heart. When your heart aligns to his heart, your will aligns to his will, then he can give you the desires of your heart. Then he can give you what you will, because you're willing in your life. Your will is the same thing that God wants in your life. You want what God wants. Your will is God's will. And so then it's no longer about you. You become like Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. You said, Lord, when Jesus said, Lord, take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. That's ultimate submission. Mm-hmm. That's ultimate sacrifice. That's ultimate, when you're at the ultimate place in Christ of God, when you can say, God, it's not about my will, but thy will be done. And so, but when we're praying these immature, egocentric prayers that it's all about me and I want this and I want that, and God's saying, but I don't want that for you. You know, if you would draw closer to me, God is saying, if you would draw closer to me, your heart would change. Your perspective would change. Your dynamics would change. The desires of your heart would change. Mm-hmm. And you would begin to desire what I desire for you. Man, when we get to that place where we desire in our life, when you desire in your life what God desires for you, boom, that's ultimate blessing. That's when God's favor opens up in your life. Check your condition. In order to maintain your condition, you've got to begin to pray prayers that align with what God wants for your life.
Prayer maintains your condition. The more you strengthen your prayer, the more you strengthen your condition in God. The more you strengthen, you know, your prayer life and your prayer style, the more that God is going to reveal himself to you. When Moses needed to hear from God, he went to the mountain and prayed. When Jesus was going to start his mission, he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Prayer is important to every believer. To every believer, and like Pastor was saying, like, it's not just, okay, let me pray for my food today. It's spending time in him. It's praying in whatever. You could be working at your job in front of your computer and be praying. You could be, you know, doing the yard work outside and be praying. You could be sitting there watching TV and God tells you, shut the TV off. so that you can pray. You can pray and doing all kinds of things in your home, but God wants to strengthen particular areas in our life. And maintaining our condition, maintaining our prayer life is one of the ways that we're going to maintain our condition in Him. And sometimes people who fall away from God because they never develop a strong prayer life. They never developed a strong relationship with God. When we begin to pray, it pleases the Spirit of God. It pleases it so that, you know, what's that thing we always say? God is not moved by our need. God is moved by our faith. So what is your faith like? What is your prayer life like? Because prayer releases the Spirit of God to work on our behalf. And so for so long, we've heard preachers say, you know, prayer changes things. But we believe that this statement in itself is complete because incomplete mm-hmm. because in my walk with God, I've learned that prayer produces God's will in our life. Like as he was saying earlier, sometimes we're praying for very specific things, but God wants us to pray for His will in our life. What does God want in our life? What does God desire for us in our life? Jesus prayed, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done." Why did he pray this? Why did Jesus, the God's only Son, here, sinless, died on a cross? Why did he pray that? You would think that he would already know what he needed to do, but why would he even say that? It's because Jesus knew that God's will was already set in heaven. He knew that God's will was already at work. He already knew that God's will was about to come to pass, and he knew that his humanistic side of you know, maybe somebody else could do this or something else could happen. He knew that part, his will was not going to be done. God's will was going
to
be done.
You know, it's like this whole thing we're going through now. We have to understand everything that's going on right now in your life. Let's not even talk about the world. Let's talk about your life and my life. First of all, we are products of our own decisions. We are products. You are where you are because you decided to be there. You know, it doesn't matter if you grew up in the roughest side of town or the hood or the ghetto or you grew up rich or poor. It don't matter. You ultimately decide who you want to be and who you want to become. Mm-hmm. So where you are right now, the place you are, you decided to be there. You decided who you were going to marry. You decided you weren't going to get married. You decided your sins. You decided your good times. You decided your bad time. Now, there are things that happen to us that aren't our decisions. But ultimately, and even in those things that happen to us that we had no control of, we decide how we're going to respond to it. Mm-hmm. And so how we decide ultimately brings us where we are.
Yeah.
And so we've got to understand that, and even in that, even where we are right now with this all this virus stuff, listen, God is not left out of the picture of this. God knew when Jesus was standing in that garden, Jesus said, "Lord, I pass this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, thy will be done." He knew that God was ultimately in charge. And so we've got to understand that where you are, wherever you are in your life, God is not left out of the picture. God's in control of this whole thing. When this thing started, when this whole thing started, a lot of people who were scared, who were fearful, we didn't know, you know, even us, we didn't know what was going on. People are asking, "Pastor, when are we going to start going back to church?" I don't know. When are we going, what's our first Sunday? Nobody knows. Things are changing from day to day, from week to week. But guess what? God knows.
Yeah.
God knows exactly what's going on. God knows your situation. God knows your circumstance. That's why it's important in this season that you pray, because that's your connection to God. Mm-hmm. It's prayer. It's you seeking God. It's you taking a moment to find God's face, taking a moment to get in God's presence. That's where you're going to find your strength. That's where you're going to find your encouragement. That's where you're going to find it. Listen, it's not just logging online to hear pastor, to hear this pastor and that. Listen, you can get that. It's you face to face. There is no pastor on earth that can give you what God can give you. There is no preacher on earth that can give you what God can give you. God can give you more in one moment in your prayer closet, in one moment, in a moment of worship. God can give you more in that moment than what any preacher on this earth can give you. You just got to create a time to seek God. Because like I started off, we started off this thing by saying, listen, don't get complacent.
Yeah.
Don't get complacent. The enemy of faith is complacency. The enemy of motivation and movement is complacency. Don't get complacent. Get up from that dry place. Get up from that slumber. Get up from that discouragement and begin to move closer to God. Move closer, and that happens in prayer.
Yeah. If you have a prayer need tonight, go ahead and write it in our comments or shoot us a message so that we can pray for you. But we want to pray for you, not just for whatever it is that you're, but I want you to know that our prayers, yeah, we can, our prayers rise up to God, but imagine what your prayers can do for your petition. And that's the faith that we want to get to. That's the level of faith that whatever it is that you're believing for, when we submit it to God, that we know that we believe God, God can answer us, but nevertheless, not our will be done, but His will. And so we want to pray whatever you have. We want to stand in agreement with you. We want to pray with you because we serve a prayer answering God. We serve a God that can heal, a God that can restore, a God that can provide, a God that can deliver us. And so we want to call upon His name tonight. So whatever it is that you're believing for, we're going to stand in agreement. But I want you to, if you haven't, you know, maybe gotten to that level of your faith where, you know, like, okay, I can tell Pastor my petition, but I'm going to believe very much so because my life stands on the line. My life is on the line right now. So we want to stand and believe with you tonight for whatever it is that you're believing for. Look, I know that a lot of businesses are starting to open up again, and a lot of people are fearful to go back to work. A lot of people are saying, I'm not ready to go back to work. I'm not ready to go back because I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know if my job's going to be safe. I don't know if they're going to be sanitized and clean, and or you don't know if you encounter with a lot of people in the public, you don't know if one of them's going to come into close contact with you. There's a lot of people that are fearful going back to work.
There's people who never stopped working.
Yeah.
There's people who never stopped working. You're in the medical field, you worked at a hospital, you're an essential employee. People work at Home Depot, Walmart. There's people who never stop working. Mm-hmm. And so I want to tell you, listen, God's hand is in this thing. Yeah. And so we're going to pray tonight. That's what we've been talking about. We're going to pray. And so we have a couple of prayer requests. Cindy's asking to pray for her family. Mondo Rivera says, prayer for my stepfather, Jose Bansan, was admitted Sunday for coronavirus. He is in an induced coma. Oh, man, we want to pray for them. We also want to pray for, like who we're talking about, everybody who's continuing going to work and people who are going back to work. And so if you need prayer, just write down there. We're going to pray for these specific prayer requests. Mm-hmm. And we know, listen, at the end of the day, God's in control, man. And you're not left alone in this thing. Yeah. We're praying for you. We know you're praying for us. And if you're not, start praying for us. Amen. We need your prayers just like you need our prayers. Amen. But let's pray today. Come on, let's pray. Father, we just pray right now for Cindy, Jesus, who's asking prayer for her family, her husband, her sons. We just pray for them, her family, all of them, and cover them with your hand and cover them with your blood. We pray for Mondo Rivera, who's father, for his stepfather, Jose, who's admitted for coronavirus. We pray that you just put your hand upon him, Lord. I'm sure he's surrounded by other patients. Let your hand be put upon him and heal, Father, and bring him out of that situation, God. We thank you for you're in control. We pray, God, in the name of Jesus, for everyone who is going back to work, Father. We pray, Father, for everyone who's on their way back, for Abby's mother, who's going back to work, on Monday. We pray for her in the name of Jesus. We pray, Father, for all of our police officers, all of our firefighters, all of our first responders, God, who are in Live Stream Church, and even those who are around, God, not just the ones that go to our church, but all of them. God, set your hand on them, Father. Protect them. Let faith arise in them. Yes, and I pray for tonight, Lord, as my wife gave this word, God, I pray that this word will become life in us, that we will that people will move into prayer. That, Father, we will not grow complacent, God, but that we will begin to pray, that we will begin to seek your face, that we will begin to just find you, God, in powerful, powerful ways. I just declare it in the name of Jesus. I thank you for everything you're doing, for what you're going to do, Father. And I know that you are working, Lord. I know that you are moving, Father, in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I thank you for a powerful move that's going to happen upon our church, upon our people. I thank you for everything you're doing. I thank you for everything you're moving in the name of Jesus. Baby, can you just pray for, since it's Mother's Day weekend coming on, can you pray for all of our moms and just in women in general?
Yeah.
Because I know women hold things in their heart differently than men. Mm-hmm. Can you just pray for them?
Yes. Heavenly Father, I thank you for every woman that's watching tonight, God. I pray, Lord Father God, that you will, for every mom, Lord, I pray, Lord, even, Father God, we've never gone through a pandemic during Mother's Day, God, and normally a day that is set aside to honor all of our moms, to honor all of the women in our life that, Father God, have worked so hard to raise all of us, God. I pray, Lord Father God, that you will strengthen their faith during this time, God. I pray, Father God, that as women, as Father God, as protectors of our home, as overseers of our children, of overseers of our husbands, of our partners, Father, I pray, Lord Jesus, that you will just strengthen us during this time.
Yes, Lord.
Strengthen us, Father God, to be the women that you have called us to be, God. I pray, Lord Father God, that you will give us eyes to see, ears to hear, Father God, of things that the enemy would try to cause in our home, division or anger, whatever it is, God. I pray, Lord Father God, that you will strengthen our faith, Father God, to see what the enemy would try to do to cause division in our home, God. I pray that you, Father God, will make us peacemakers in our home. I pray, Lord Father God, that you will, Father God, cause us, Lord Father God, to speak life into our children, to speak life into our family, to speak life into our situations, God. Lord, you know, Father God, the desires of our heart. You know, Father God, the tears that that we cry, Father God, at night, the things that burden us, God. I pray, Lord Father God, that we can lift every burden unto you, God, and that we will find rest in you, Lord. I pray for every single, Father God, mom, Father God, that's out there that maybe is praying for their child that's in jail, that's praying for their child that's sick, that's praying for their child struggling in school, that's praying for their child struggling at work, Father God. Lord, you know the desires of our heart. You know the things that burden us, God. And Lord, we just pray that you will, Father God, lift those burdens from us, God. That we can put our trust in you. That we can put our faith in you, God. I pray, Lord, Father God, that you will, Father God, just raise up, Father God, more Esthers and more Deborahs, Father God, and more Marys, Father God, that we will, Father God, be strong in our faith. That we will stand up for what's right. That we will say no to the enemy when he tries to cause division in our family, God. I pray, Lord Father God, that you will, Father God, do something new within us, God. You haven't given us, Father God, a spirit of fear. I pray, Lord Father God, that you will strengthen us in our word, strengthen us in our faith, God. In your Son Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, I'm excited about what God's doing. I thank you for joining us here tonight. And y'all pray for me, man. Ooh, I've been eating a little too much. Praise the Lord. I'm looking at myself here. I'm like, my God, it's time to get back to work.
My mom says she's going to the doctor. Mom, we're praying and believing for you. She's, some of you know, my mom had... was diagnosed with a cancerous tumor last year, and they removed it. And so the doctors had told her with the type of tumor it was a slow-growing tumor, and it doesn't spread, but it does come back. And so she has her follow-up appointment this upcoming Friday. So we're going to be praying for you, Mom.
All right. Good. We'll be praying for you, Suegra, and praying for everybody. Well, we thank you so much for joining us here tonight. We know that all of you guys are experiencing something different and where you are. But more than anything, I want you to know you are blessed. Come on. My favorite song right here. Come on. One of my favorites. Come on. How many are blessed? Let's end this night with a praise on our lips and declaring that we're blessed and we're highly favored in the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. Dave and Marissa said, great message, awesome word from both of you. Justice said, thank you for the word, Abby.
Oh, thank you.
Amen. I think they like you better than me. I think I'm convinced of that.
I think you're right. No, I'm just like,
yeah, I think you're right. And you know what? I'm completely okay with that. No. I'm completely okay with that.
Well, we miss all of you guys. Hey, if you're watching tonight and if you're in the Houston area and maybe you don't have a home church to go to, I want to invite you to join us. Come whenever we open up our doors again. We want to personally meet you. And so if maybe you're watching and you haven't been to church in a while, in a couple of months, like some of us. But we are hoping to see everyone that is watching, everyone that's tuning in. Look, when we have our services and we have our doors opened up, we are going to have a praise party. So y'all get ready, because we're excited for what God's going to do.
Praise the Lord. So thank you so much. Listen, I don't know about you, but I've been enjoying our Sunday worship. Man, I want to give props to our worship team, Karen and Pedro. You guys have been doing a phenomenal job heading this up. You guys have just been...
Emma and all the guest people
that have been guest singers, Rafa this past week, all of our guest musicians that have been part of it. I want to thank you all. I don't know about y'all, but I've been enjoying it. How many have been enjoying it? Amen. Reach out to each other. I mean, reach out to Karen and to Emma and all them. Tell them what a great job. Reach out to each other. Call each other. Pray for each other. Text each other. Message each other. Just check on each other. Be the church to each other. Amen.
It's good online, but I can't wait for live praise and worship.
Yeah, I can't wait. You know, I can't. And worship team's always a... George is always texting me, Pastor, how you doing? You know, can't wait to get back. You know, we're doing good. And so I know all of us are excited to get back in the church, huh? And just to be together. And so I'm excited about that. So we'll see. We'll keep you updated. Listen, when we know, you'll know. But until then, here we are. This is our church, and we're gathering right here online. And we're gonna enjoy every moment of it. We're gonna just seek after God. This thing can't stop us from getting closer to God. Remember, it's your responsibility to maintain your condition, your spirit condition with the Lord. Amen. Let's work out in the spiritual. Don't forget, work out in the spiritual, and let's start working out in the physical too. Amen. I've been eating a lot. Praise the Lord. I had some of the best. I don't know why I'm gonna say this, but I had some of the best tortillas I've ever had on yesterday on Cinco de Mayo. I'm going to tell you, my mom got mad. But man, my neighbor brought us some tortillas that his sister made. My Lord, my Lord. Woo, they were some good.
You may have to get a special order for the cafe. Breakfast tacos, like these are some good tortillas.
There were some good tortillas. Let me see. Santiago said, Pastor, can I borrow your glasses? Yes, sir. If you notice, you guys are making fun of me. You notice I'm putting glasses on now when I'm reading. It has happened. Yes, I do need some reading glasses. Every time I look at my phone, look at a menu. Getting old is horrible.
Yeah. Someone's birthday's coming up.
Yes. I wonder who.
May 24th.
Amen. I'm getting older. Praise the Lord. We'll see. I don't know what we're gonna do. We're gonna do something.
Yeah,
we're gonna do something for my birthday. And then it's your birthday in June. There's a lot of birthdays going on. But anyway, We've talked enough. Happy birthday to everyone out there who's had a birthday during this quarantine and during this stay-at-home thing. We love you, Livestream Church. We miss you. God bless you. Thank you God so much you. For joining us. And we will see you on Sunday. God bless you.
Amen.